Well, it's so good to be back here, even if it is hot. I believe like one said in the Old Testament, I was happy when they said unto us, let's go to the house of the Lord.
Amen.
And now, it's indeed a hot evening, and to you visitors that's with us, you can see why Indiana's hard to live down here around in this swamp. I tell you, it's only 93 at that. 93. So you see, when you get down to around 120 like it is in Louisiana and Arizona, you can realize what it is then. How you really get in. If that was here, we'd just perish. That would be all. But it's good to be here to put in this time of worship. After I went home this morning, I just felt real, real good about, I believe that many were healed this morning that don't realize it maybe to this time, but they'll get well.
Amen.
Because the word of the Lord was precious this morning to our hearts.
Amen.
I was just when I started to leave, it looked like this walls were almost breathing with the kind of inflating with the Holy Spirit so in here. And I was so happy for that. I was hearing Brother Smith, my friend, pray just a few moments ago, the pastor of the Church of God, Anderson. And Brother Smith has a little track. I don't guess we give him out here at the tabernacle. If any of you haven't got that little track, you read it. That's an astounding little track. It's absolutely the scriptural truth. And I've taken many of them to Chicago and different places to distribute them because they are really a truthful, wonderful track. And I know they were wrote from a heart that's loyal and loves God.
Amen.
No selfish motive behind Brother Smith. Just all Christian.
Amen.
So we are happy to be associated tonight with people of that caliber.
Amen.
I believe I see my good friend Brother Borders here from up in California. And he've done a great job for me just recently for the Lord up in there beginning the San Jose meeting together. I hope you'll do as good a job on the next one coming, Brother Borders. And I like Brother Borders because I find in him a meek, gentle spirit.
Amen.
And I think that's a great price. I think a man that has that type of spirit ought to be very happy. There's so many others in here that I just can't enumerate who they are. I see Brother Collins back there, our brother, and other ministers, and our good friend Brother Southman, his family from northern Saskatchewan. And I know Brother Evans is here. I haven't seen him as yet, but I've seen his family. And from down Georgia, and there's Brother Palmer there, and from down in Georgia, and Brother West, I believe from Alabama, Georgia. Where are you from, Brother West? Huntsville. And then oh, we're just happy to see all you in here. And now, Brother Lyle back there, Wood from the up in northern Indiana, and his loved ones. And I think Brother Charlie's here, my old partner, hunting partner from down in Kentucky, second the best squirrel hunter in Kentucky. Second the best squirrel hunter. You'll make me pay for that. All right, and his wife and family, and all of you, Christian greetings. Little brother here, I can't think of his name here, and different ones. But you all know that I sure appreciate you coming out tonight to worship with us at the tabernacle. And now, tonight is an unusual night at the tabernacle. Because it's question and answer night. And that usually comes about once every year or two. And the reason I do that is to keep in mind what's on the people's mind. so that I'll know just what their questions is. Have everybody just throw a question in and then answer it from the platform. Now, in this, I didn't get, I thought it would be very strong, but I got just a very few questions, so it won't take us long to answer them. I was thinking I'd get a whole tray full, but just a very few and very simple. But some of them pertain to doctrines. And in this doctrine, I'll have to answer the question of the people not knowing who they were, because many didn't put their names on the question. And therefore, I'll have to answer it according to the doctrine that we stand for at the tabernacle.
Amen.
And by doing that, and if it happens to kind of cross up a little wire on some of our visiting brethren or sisters, we wouldn't have that done for nothing. We don't believe in anyone fussing over just little scriptural points. We believe that Christ died to save us all.
Amen.
And we're all saved through His blood. But as a church and as a people's, a congregation, we have to have a doctrine that we stand for in order to be a church. And this doctrine that we stand for is the best of our knowledge to the Word of God, the truth of God. Now, you have a perfect right to look at it a different way, if you wish to. And therefore, if someone asks me questions here, a couple of them are rather steep, and I'd answer now just the best that I know. Now, here's the way I try to handle a question. A question, if a person can take just one scripture and could almost make it say anything you want it to say. But the Scripture, every Scripture, is the truth. And it's so perfect until the infinite God who spoke the Scripture, it's so perfect that it never has an ending.
Amen.
So therefore, it will travel from Genesis to Revelations, the same thing. It'll never vary. And then if the Bible is the inspired Word of God, it'll never cross itself up no place. It'll go all the way through the Scripture. Now, many times, as I was rather a little rude this morning in preaching Samson and Delilah and a church in worldliness, but I don't mean to be rude, but I mean to be honest.
Amen.
Just as honest as my convictions is.
Amen.
Now, in the Scriptures, them being the infallible Word of God, I believe that there's only one thing that can rightly interpret the Scripture, that is the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
I believe that's it. And the Holy Spirit who wrote the Scriptures and said they are no private interpretation. Therefore, if it'll run all the way through the Scriptures, it must be the same Holy Spirit then, all the way through, to interpret it. But now, many peoples in their churches and their faiths have differences, little something that they hold on to that might be just a little contrary. If they are, just do it like I do when I'm eating cherry pie. I never eat the seed. When I hit a seed, I just throw the seed out and continue eating pie. So that's what you do. I see our sister Wooten has her little baby standing there. If he's hot, sister, and you don't have a seat, I wonder if one of our brethren couldn't take a seat from the inside and set it back there by the fan so sister can have a cool place to sit down. We'd be glad to do that, I'm sure. Any of these brothers, a fan back there, sister, right? Blowing this way, and there's the seat. If you want to use it, you just go right ahead. Now, any of you brethren that wish to take off your coats, just go right ahead and make yourself feel well and happy. Now, I'm going to ask the body that if they will pray for me, this next week I have to go to California, all the way over there for one night of service. Just one night to preach at the Christian Businessmen's International Convention. But they've advertised it, and we're expecting many thousands of people to be there, and I would not want to disappoint them. And I told them I would come if I didn't be in Australia at this time, which I was scheduled to be. So pray for us. Many of you, dear pilgrims of this earth, that's on your vacation from your daily task and would like to be in one of the meetings, there will be a three-day service at Cleveland, Tennessee, the Church of God. I think that's the Pentecostal Church of God, Tomlinson Move. Brother Littlefield, David Littlefield, is pastor. A very fine Christian gentleman. He's a Yankee from the north, from Bangor, Maine, but a real Christian fine brother. And so if you're in your journey and would like to come up, perhaps Monday night will be the dedication of the huge big tabernacle that they built. And then Tuesday and Wednesday night of next week, the Lord willing, not this coming week, the following week, will be healing services, which will be 6th, 7th, and 8th. Now, before we open the Word, I would like if we would bow our heads just a moment for prayer. Lord God, precious Father of us all, who brought again the Lord Jesus from the dead and has presented Him to us in the form of the Holy Spirit, after being crucified, died, buried, rose on the third day and ascended into glory, we're now sitting at the right hand of the Majesty on high, ever living to make intercession. A high priest that can be touched by the feeling of our infirmities and knows even the tiniest sparrow that would fall to the street. How could he ever pass by the loyalty of his children sitting tonight in this hot building just to hear the Word? I'm sure, Lord God, if we didn't even ask that You would pour out Your blessings upon them for their gallantry of standing by their post of duty tonight. There are visitors here, Lord. We pray for them and their churches. There are ordained ministers of the gospel, ordained of God, sitting present, who's far more sufficient to answer these questions than I. And I pray, Lord God, that You let the Holy Spirit come to us tonight and give us the right things to say that would bring joy unspeakable and full of glory to our hearts as we sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, studying the Scriptures without prejudice, without any ill feelings, but only to know what is truth and to worship the truth.
Amen.
Grant it, Lord. We would ask to bless our dear pastor, Brother Neville, who stood gallantly at the post of duty year after year through the hot and cold to herd and to pasture the sheep of the flock that gathers here. Pray that Your Spirit be upon him. Help him and bless all that's connected with the tabernacle. And soon, Lord, if it be Your will, we expect the lovely big tabernacle standing here on the corner where we can have a school, that we might school young ministers and send them to the four corners of the earth.
Amen.
To earnestly contend for the faith that was once delivered to the saints. Lord, we're getting old myself, and soon I must pass the Bible back into the hands of someone else. Help us, Lord, in this effort. Answer our question tonight by the Holy Spirit as we trust in Him.
Amen.
For we ask it in the name of Jesus, Thy Son. Amen. I know it's awfully hot, but I never like to pass by a question until I think I have did justly before God to answer it. Now, we don't have very many. I never counted them, just a very few. But it could be that we might not get to all of them, but we want to, if possible. I'm going to ask this little girl in pink sitting here. Come here, honey. I believe that's Brother Beeler's little girl. I want you to take these questions down there and just mix them up. You know what I mean? Just cross one over the other like this, you know, so then bring them back to me. See? So that I won't mix anybody's questions, you know, thinking I just answered one and didn't get to the other one. I wouldn't want that. Just let the little girl just mix them up together, and then we'll just take the ones right off the top and answer them as we come. Now, if there would be, thank you, sweetheart, if there would happen to be a question in somebody's mind, I want to say that I'd be glad if after I've answered your question and it doesn't seem satisfying, then you just raise your hands and answer. For I also have here the Greek, Hebrew, both Greek and Hebrew in the original lexicon, for information of the words, you see, because some of them are asking words, the Hebrew and the Greek also. And now, the Lord help us as we answer. Let me clearly state it. Can you hear me good in the back? Raise up your hands if you can. That's good. Let me clearly state now that in answering these questions, it's not for any prejudice. But everyone remembers that in the tabernacle, if it comes into doctrine, we have to answer it according to our convictions here, not to cross up your ideas, but to bring our convictions. And sometimes we nail it down pretty tight. So remember, it's only to make it sure to the worshipers. Now, the first one on top, oh yes, this is a little question. It's not a question, it is a question. It's someone who would like a private interview with me the first of the week. Now, that interview, I'll tell you how we do that. It used to be that we just at random caught catch can who first this, that. But we got a system to that. And therefore, there's many people who come into the prayer lines that maybe pass through a fast line or have a proposition that don't know what to do about it. And then they want to hear from the Lord. Now, they have a perfect right to that. That's what this prophetic gift was given for, is for that purpose alone. In the Bible, if they wanted to know anything, they went down to the prophets and they prayed and sang hymns until God answered. Why, He's not a God that would feed one group and starve another group to death. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And therefore, that's what it's for. On these private interviews, when we take a case, I never leave it until I hear from God, one way or the other. They come slow. If it takes 6 months or a year, we stay right with it till we have, thus saith the Lord. See? And therefore, they come slow, and there's thousands of calling. But the other day, I had a man in there I believe it would have been months after months, this man had sought for the baptism of the Holy Spirit, a Baptist. But we didn't turn him loose, just let him come. And finally, by the grace of God, on a private interview, just walked in. He had always wanted to see a vision, what was the matter, and the vision struck, and he received the Holy Ghost sitting right in his chair.
Amen.
Then a Catholic recently converted, come down from Chicago the other day, which has been on private interviews trying to get in for at least 2 years. But on his first interview, 15 minutes in the room, the Lord showed a vision, the reason, and all revealed the whole thing, what he had to do before he received the Holy Ghost. See, that's what it's for. Now, if anyone at any time, when calls come in and they want to see or have those interviews, if they'll call Butler 21519, the office can post you just exactly when the interview can be, and then state what your interview is for, so they'll know how much time to allot it. Then that makes it just then every person. Then if that amount of time doesn't suffice, then we come back to that case again. It's put right on record, and we keep it until we hear from God by a vision or some way that God speaks. So that's how our interviews are kept. Therefore, see, when I'm out, the people think sometimes, Brother Branham, you don't see the people enough. You can't see the people and be with God at the same time. See, I got somebody in view, and I'm in the cave or somewhere else praying, and I want to see what this says. And a couple of days is up and out. And what's that?
Just the doctor wanted to cut that man's heart open. There was nothing wrong with him. He just needed to get out of that casket. That man from Chicago.
Oh yeah.
And the doctor wanted to operate and take his heart off.
Yes. Yeah. That this was the man. Gene just put it up here that a man came down from Chicago the other day that the doctor wanted to cut his heart out and cut it open to see what was the matter on the inside. And the Holy Spirit revealed just exactly what it was, and he didn't need to be cut open. He was healed. So you see, that means lots. And to show you how slow it comes, I waited myself for an answer from God for a vision for 15 years. God, and then another come and won't have to wait 3 minutes. See? It just, God answers in his own time. We don't control it. It controls us. Now, the second question laying on top is, Brother Bill, can the Lord do effective work through me in a congregation where they do not believe in the spiritual gifts? No name on it. But the person wants to know if the Lord can work with them as they are officiated in a congregation that does not believe in spiritual gifts. I doubt it very much. I'm very much in doubt, dear friend, that the Lord could efficiently work through you because you are linked up among unbelievers. And the Bible said, yoke yourself not up with unbelievers, but come out from among them and be ye separated, saith the Lord. Then I will receive you. I believe if you live in a city where there is a church that does believe in signs and spiritual gifts, and you have them things working on you, I would go to that church where they believed it. And then I might say another thing, as I usually want to give a scripture. You probably, dear friend, tried your very best to try to get these people to believe, tried to make them believe, and they simply won't do it, perhaps. Then I'm going to give you a scripture that I believe that the Lord Jesus would be pleased with us giving. If you've tried, if you've talked to the pastor, if you've talked to different ones, and they completely ignore it, and do not believe it. Here's what Jesus said in Matthew 7:6 about such. Give not that which is holy unto the dogs, neither cast your pearls before swine, lest they trample them under their feet and turn and rend you. So I do not believe that I would be affiliated with a congregation who did not believe in the full gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. To believe that He was the same yesterday, today, and ever, when I sit in a congregation and see Him working and doing just as He said He would do, I believe I'd feel exactly as justified in telling people to come out from among such and find you a good church who preaches all the Scriptures and believes them.
Amen.
Now, the next question is it true that you are not saved unless you have received the Holy Ghost? That could take about a good 5-hour discussion on that. When you accept Christ as your Savior and are then ready for baptism in water, you have not yet been converted. You're only believing unto repentance. Conversion means to be changed. Now, to make this efficient, Jesus said to Peter, who had also followed Him for 3.5 years, and in the book of Matthew, the 10th chapter, Jesus gave Peter power against unclean spirits to go out and cast them out, to heal the sick, and to preach the gospel. He had power to do this, and in St. John 17:17, Jesus sanctified Peter through the truth, said the Word was the truth and He was the Word. And then at before Pentecost, He said, after you are converted, then strengthen your brethren.
Amen.
You are only taking steps to conversion as you believe and are acting. Now, I know many of you, my Baptist and Presbyterian friends, disagree with that. Because you go back to this Scripture. Now, here's where I say I have to nail it down, see? You go back to the Scripture, Abraham, Romans 4, believed God, and it was imputed unto him, or imparted unto him, for righteousness. Abraham believed God. And God imputed it to him for righteousness upon the basis of his faith to believe. But to prove to Abraham, He gave him the imputation that he was imputed from his sins. Then He had imparted him from his sins because he had believed. He gave him a sign. And that's where you, my dear Presbyterian and Baptist friends, fail to see it. See, He gave him the seal of circumcision as a witness, as a proof that he had received his faith in Him. And that's why Paul in Acts 19 said to those Baptist brethren who had Apollos as their pastor, believing the gospel as John had preached it, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? You see, they had believed but had not yet been converted. Now, we take the wrong the word of conversion today. We say that a man that's converted is a man that's stopped drinking and everything and goes to church or joins the church. He might join the church, but that's no sign he's converted. He isn't converted until his old life is dead and he is buried in Christ and is risen with Him and the resurrection of newness of life. When the Holy Spirit has created in him a living hope of eternal life which only comes through the Holy Ghost. Now, I know that great scripture, I use it myself. I've got it written here. St. John, the 5th chapter, 24th verse. It's a pet scripture to me. For Jesus said this, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me has eternal life." Let me read it, so that I'll get it just perfectly right. St. John 5. And I want you to listen close now as we go into this scripture. 5 and the 24th verse. "Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that heareth my words and believeth on him that sent me has everlasting life and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life. He that believeth on me." Now, the scripture says that no man can say Jesus is the Christ only by the Holy Ghost. So you cannot believe that Jesus is the Christ until you have received the baptism of the Holy Ghost. You're only testifying or saying what the scripture says, saying what the pastor says, saying what mother says or some good preacher says, but you don't know it yourself until he has witnessed his resurrection to you. No man can call Jesus the Christ until by the Holy Ghost. Therefore, the question is that a man is saved, I believe, if he's looking towards Calvary and dies in that estate. Certainly I believe he'll be saved. I believe he'd go through if he had not the opportunity before. But depends on you go back to the dying thief at the cross. But remember, that was his first and last chance. You got one tonight. Don't wait till that time. Because it might not be that way with you. You might not have a deathbed confession. I tell you, they're all right, but they're too much of a chance to take a chance on. Don't you wait for deathbed. You let this be your deathbed right now, that you die out now and be born again of the Holy Spirit. Now, on this next question, now if there's a question on that, just raise your hand. I'll be glad to do the best I can. Can you find anywhere the apostles took communion after Pentecost? Did Paul mean people do not discern the Word? Holy Ghost was the only way to worship God. If you take wine and crackers, sickness and sleep fall on you. Now, here is maybe a place that I believe the dear person that asked this is no doubt deeply and sincerely, and this what they're asking, or they wouldn't ask it. And I, my brother or sister, whoever it was, I answer it just as deeply and sincerely as you answered it or asked it. I want you now to turn with me unto the book of Acts, the 2nd chapter. And with the, we begin with the 42nd verse. The 2nd chapter of the Acts. And we'll begin, as I said, with the 42nd verse. Now, remember, I do not believe that I could say just exactly where the scripture says that Paul took the communion and Peter then reached over and taken it. But when they're talking of the congregation, that was in whole, everybody. And I do not believe that Paul would preach something and tell others to do that he would not do. So in the Acts we find this, "And they continually steadfast in the apostles' doctrine, fellowship," watch, They continued, the whole church, the body, continually steadfast in the apostles' doctrine and in fellowship and conjunction there, see, and in breaking of bread, that's a communion, and in prayers. The apostles, who was the preachers, they continually steadfast in their doctrine of breaking of bread, communion, and in fellowship and in prayer. Then if that cuts out communion from the apostles, it also cuts out prayer from the apostles. See? Now, just read on. See? And fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done by the apostles, and all the believers were together, and had all things common, and they sold their possessions and goods and parted them to every man, as every man had need, and they continuing daily in one accord in the temple, that's apostles and all, breaking bread, communion, every time they met. That was a doctrine of the apostles and of the early church, that every time they came together, they'd taken communion. Every time. Now, I know you Christian people who go to the Christian church, the Carmelite church, as we know it, as because there's two of them. One's the Church of Christ, and the other's the Carmelite church. You say, we take it every Sunday morning. We got the scriptures on it. You have a better scripture on it than the Branham Tabernacle does. The Branham Tabernacle takes it once a month. But the scripture is that as oft as you come together. That's right. That's every time. And they continued daily in one accord in the temple, breaking bread from house to house, did eat their meat with gladness and singleness of heart. See, each time the apostles holding these prayer groups, meetings in the temple, house to house, every time they met, they broke bread, taking the communion. Now, Paul, in 1 Corinthians, we could also read the 11th chapter, where we use here for a communion. I might read it so it might be able to help you. 1 Corinthians, the 11th chapter. Listen to Paul speaking now. 23rd verse. For I have received of the Lord that which I also delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had gave thanks, he brake it and said, take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And if the same manner, also he took the cup, and when he had supped, saying, the cup now, this is the cup of the New Testament, my blood. This do as oft as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as oft as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show forth the Lord's death till he comes. See? It's a communion. I do realize and do agree that the body of the Lord, the living Word, is Christ himself. But these are symbols just like baptism and foot wash and other ordinances of the church. But communion is absolutely essential for the bread. Now, bread and wine. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily. Now, the question was asked here, you taking wine and crackers, sickness and sleep on you. See, that I believe that the question is that the only worship there is in the Holy Spirit. Worshiping in the Holy Spirit, that is exactly the truth. You have to worship, all worship's in the Holy Spirit. And Paul's trying to say here that you must be in the Holy Spirit before you do this, or you eat and drink damnation to yourself. Okay? Before you do this, before the order's carried out. Now, to back that up, I got a writing here of Josephus, where he claimed that the early Christians, after the death of Jesus, that they were considered cannibals because they took the body of the Lord and eat it, and they thought they had dug it up and had took it out and was cutting it up by pieces and eating it, which they were taking the communion. See? Now watch. While this scripture, how Paul says here, but let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of the bread. Eat of the bread. Now I know Jesus is the bread of life, that's true, but this is a symbol, just like baptism. Baptism doesn't save you. Baptism is only a sign that you're witnessing to the congregation that you believe in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. It doesn't save you. Water will not save you. It's your faith that saves you. But baptism is an order, and it must be carried out. Because God can't say, be baptized, and then turn around and say, it doesn't need to be done. He cannot issue taking communion and turn around and say, you no need of taking it. You've got to do it. It's an order forever with God. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily, eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. Now, you see there? Comes right back to the Christian that's trying to take communion, that's not in Christ, not fellowshipping in the Spirit. He isn't worthy of taking it, and when he does take this communion, he's eating and drinking damnation to himself. If he's going out smoking, lying, stealing, committing adultery, or something like that, or not living a Christian life, and people see the kind of life he's living, and then coming in, taking this order of the death and body of Christ, taken into him, a symbol that he has received Christ, the Word in his heart, and taken this symbol in there behind it. He said he eats and drinks damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. Now, just in a few minutes, I'm going to get to that same question, if we get to it, because it's the same order of the blasphemy of the Holy Ghost. Because you are professing something and playing the part of hypocrite with it when you should not be doing it. All right. Let me finish this, and then we'll stop. For this cause many are sick and weakly among you, and many sleep. For if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord, that we should not be condemned with the world. Wherefore, my brethren, when you come together to eat, tarry one for the other. Now watch. And if any man hunger, don't come in, because in another scripture here, they were bringing in meat and so much drink and stuff like that, till they were making the Lord's house just a place of a feast, and getting drunk at the Lord's table. You remember that in the book of Corinthians here. They got drunk at the Lord's table. But Paul said here, if any man hunger, let him eat at home, that you come not together unto condemnation. The rest I'll set in order when I come. See? Now, therefore, I believe that the eating of the cracker, now I do not believe that kosher bread should be substituted for a cracker. I believe it should be a holy, unleavened bread, the type of the unleavened bread that was made in Egypt. And I believe that the blood should not be grape juice, but it should be wine. Grape juice sours and spoils as it gets old. But wine gets better and stronger as it gets old. It never loses its strength. And the blood of Christ doesn't sour and spoil. As it gets older, it gets stronger and better as the days goes by to the believer. And it is a literal wine and bread, communion bread, should be made by people who's dedicated themselves and consecrated themselves to God. I went to a church once where they're taking this old loaf bread, where sinners cursing and carrying on and filth, and cut up that old bread and stuck it out there with some kind of a juice to drink. To me, that was ridiculous. I believe it should be just exactly the way the Scripture said it should be. Not vary one speck from the Scriptures. Stay right with it. Question. Now, Brother Branham, is it true that Satan was once in heaven and was cast out? He and his angels come down to earth. Or is it a vision like John saw on the Isle of Patmos? Why I ask this is I was told that it was a vision. John saw it as a vision, but it was a literal happening. If you'll turn to Isaiah 14:12. Now these go slow, but to me they are lessons. And it's something that maybe you think, well, I don't have no need of that now. You just don't know how that Holy Spirit feeds on the Word of God. It's got to have the Word to feed on, because the Holy Spirit feeds only and only on the Word of God. You believe that? The Bible said so. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. All right. The 14th chapter of Isaiah, and I believe here now we're going to begin at the 12th verse. Let's read now about Lucifer. How art thou falling from heaven, O Lucifer? Fallen from heaven. Son of the morning, an angelic being from the heavens. How art thou falling from heaven, O Lucifer? Son of the morning, how art thou cut down to the ground, which didst walk, weaken the nations? For thou didst say in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven, and I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation, in the sight of the north. I will ascend above the highest of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. So you see, it wasn't a vision. Absolutely, Lucifer was cast out of heaven. Now, let's turn to the New Testament, to Luke 10:18. Just a minute and see what Jesus said. In the book of Luke, you would have your Bibles now that's trying to get on these questions. Luke 10:18. And he said unto them, Jesus speaking, I beheld Satan as lightning falling from heaven. See, Satan was the original archangel of God. He once dwelt in the heavens. He once was the greatest person in the heavens outside of God. He was God's right-hand man, the fellowship. And he got puffed up in his heart. And isn't that just the way that people get today? Let God just bless a fellow and put a little confidence in him, and he gets to be a know-it-all. He gets to be, he's got to start an organization, he's got to do something that's different. Why art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer? God has a hard time trying to get somebody that he can deal with that'll stay humble and meek and stay in the place until God calls him to do something. You believe that?
Amen.
See? A man that God can bless and he'll still keep himself a man, not be an angel or a god. As soon as man gets blessed and has a little something given to him, he wants to become a god. He wants to become an angel. He wants to become some great person. What I do, what me and mine, all that. That's the wrong attitude. God's hunting for somebody who he can bless and pour out the blessings, and more he bless, the little the man will become. Amen. And you'll never get more of God until you become nothing.
Amen.
You've got to belittle yourself. He that will exalt himself, God will bring abased. He that will humble himself, God will exalt. You've got to get little before you can get big. And you'll never be big in your own self. You'll only be as big as God will be big in you.
Amen.
See? So Lucifer is on earth today trying to work in the church to accomplish the same purpose that he started before the foundation of the world.
Amen.
Lucifer was kicked out of heaven. All right. I believe... There's another thing on here. Ezekiel, the 28th chapter, the 12th verse. Let's see what that says. In Ezekiel 28:12. And I'm sure that by studying this and looking into it, seeing what thus saith the Lord, then we know whether he really fell from heaven or whether he was just a vision. 28 and 12. All right, I believe that's what I got wrote down, 28, 12. All right, here we start. Now, this is a great thing here. I wish we just had time to preach on this a little. See? For it's really something. Now, as I just got to basing up to this, that Lucifer in heaven tried to exalt himself and even be just a little higher than his boss. And he betrayed Michael and made himself a great kingdom in the north and come down. Now, and he and his angels was cast out. The person asked of the revelation, that's on Revelation 12, on the Isle of Patmos. But now notice this here, at the 12th verse, watch how he sets in the kingdom of man. How many people here understand that the devil controls every nation under heaven? The devil controls the United States. The devil is government of the United States. The devil is a government of Germany. He's a government of every nation under heavens. The devil controls every nation. The Bible says he does. Read Matthew, the 4th chapter. When Satan took Jesus up to the top of the mountain and showed him the kingdoms of the world and claimed them to be his and said, I'll give them to you if you'll worship me. Jesus never said, you lied, Satan. He knew they belonged to him. But over in the book of Revelation said, rejoice, you heavens and you earth, for the kingdoms of this world have become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign on earth. Jesus knew that in the millennium that all the governments and kingdoms will be broke down and he'll be God and ruler over all of them. He knew he fell heir to all of it. So therefore he told Satan, get thee behind me, Satan. For he knew what he had to do. Now listen to this, the Spirit of the Lord on this prophet Ezekiel speaking not to this king, but to the Spirit in the king. Watch this now. You remember this morning when I showed you how in the Scriptures that the church got off the wrong track by taking man's organizations? Same thing, Israel got off the track by denouncing God as their king and wanted Saul for a king. And when their real king come, Jesus, they didn't know him. Because his preaching and his teaching was so much different from the earthly kings, so they didn't know him. And today, when the king of the church, the Holy Spirit, when he's here, and he comes into the church to make the people to be regenerated, to give them new birth. It's so different from these organizations and denominations. So they say, oh, that looks like holy rollers to me. See? It ain't what it looks to you. It's what God's Word says about it. Look on the day of Pentecost. What did that look like? Look at other times when they received the Holy Ghost. What did it look like? Women and men, the Virgin Mary and all of them staggering like drunk men, just reeling, screaming, stammering lips and other tongues, carrying on like a bunch of idiots. But they were dying to themselves and the Holy Ghost was coming into them. They set the known world afire. What we need today is men who will die out to themselves and rot out to themselves and burn every bridge behind and surrender everything to Christ. Amen. What's the Holy Spirit speaking now to the devil in this king? Look who this fellow was that's governing this king. You remember what I said this morning? My wife said about the woman up there, all them bunch of women with them dirty-looking vulgar clothes on. See, said they must not have their right mind. A woman's got a right mind, wouldn't expose herself like that. I said, honey, she's just an American. That's all. That's custom here. They'll do it because it's a custom. See, they go by their intellectuals. But your intellectuals, if you go by your head, you're controlled by the devil. The devil took a man's head, God takes a man's heart. Amen. The devil makes you look at something you can see. You say, well, that's right. That's right. Reason. Reason it out. But the Bible lets us cast down reasonings. And by faith we believe things that we do not see.
Amen.
That's what God does when he comes upon the human heart. In the Garden of Eden, the devil took the man's head. God took his heart. That's the throne of God where God dwells, in the human heart. And now, if it's intellectually, sure, then a man or a woman that's born of God will act like the kingdom they're from. Hallelujah! That would make me shout. Why? Because when you know that you pass from death unto life, because you hate sin and you love God, and you'll stand regardless if you die or don't die. You'll stand that it's wrong and call wrong wrong. Walk upright before God. It shows that your spirit, the life that's in you, is from another place where it's holy and pure, virgin, undefiled. And you say, divine healing? Sure. My spirit come from a place where the divine healer is. We're from a land of divine healing.
Amen.
Say you believe it, God is sure it's from the land where God is.
Amen.
And we're pilgrims and strangers, like Abraham and Isaac. When just the overshadowing of the Holy Spirit hit them, they went through the land and confessed that they were pilgrims and strangers. They were seeking a city whose builder and maker was God. And now after we've got the evidence of it living in us, how much more should we be pilgrims and strangers?
Amen.
Walking through the world, turning our head from the evil things because we are of another nation, another people. Certainly. Now watch the evil controls of this world. Now as we read from Ezekiel 28:12. Son of man, take up a lamentation to the king of Tyre and say to him, thus saith the Lord God. Now watch. He's speaking to the Spirit in the king. See? Thus saith the Lord God, thou sealest up the sun, full of wisdom, perfect in beauty. Satan, see that? How Satan was the most beautiful of the archangels. Thou hast been in Eden. Now you know the king of Tyre at that time could not have been in Eden. For it was 4,000 years before that. See? Thou hast been in Eden. Who's he talking to? He's talking to Satan and that king. Hallelujah. Brother, I feel religious. When? And then what's these people going to do that blasphemes and makes fun of people under the demonstration of the Holy Ghost? When they make fun of those people, they are blaspheming the Holy Ghost, which is absolutely unpardonable.
Amen.
You're not talking to that man. You're talking to the Spirit that's moving in that man. We are to honor one another and love one another and exhort one another. Talk good of each other. That's what we should do. Now listen to this. All right, thou sealest up the sun, full of wisdom, perfect in beauty. Thou was in Eden, the garden of God. Even precious stones was I covering. Sardis, topaz, diamonds, beryl, onyx, jasper, sapphire, emerald, carbuncle, gold, workmanship, all the tablets, all the pipes was prepared in thee in the day that thou wast created. There's Lucifer. He once dwelt in Eden. Now we're going to come back to that question in a minute. Lucifer in Eden. Because we've got the seed of the serpent down here somewhere, which is a very ticklish thing. I thought of this. Hope that's about last. But he was, and the devil was kicked out of heaven, and the very purpose that he tried to purpose in heaven, he came right down here on the earth and is trying his best to fulfill that what he purposed. He goes to the kings and to the rulers, and when he can get them, then he comes right down to the church and gets the people, or gets the preacher. Then from the preacher he goes right into the congregation. And getting the congregation under the same influence, the same devil, doing the same things. You know, you're a Presbyterian. You'll never be a holy roller. You are this, that, or the other. You couldn't afford to disgrace yourself to be amongst them. Why, you know better than to set one of them little old tabernacles or missions on the street. Well, them people's off at their head. No, they're not. No, they're not. They're just on at their heart. That's all. They're not off at their head. They're just controlled by their heart. God lives in their heart, and they are a peculiar people. A royal priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifice. That's the fruits of their lips giving praise to God. Whether they feel like it or not. At times I do not see him, said the songwriter, I trust in giving praise.
Amen.
Say, well, I'd go to church and I'd praise the Lord if I felt like it. Well, now, a priest is to make a sacrifice. And you, the congregation, are high priests of God to make a spiritual sacrifice. That's the fruits of your lips giving praise to God. You go down and say, well, if I felt like it, I'd go over and testify to somebody. Well, do it anyhow.
Amen.
If you're a high priest, brother, it's burning in your heart whether you feel like doing it or not. Go do it anyhow, because you've got to make a sacrifice, something that's hard to do. Go do it anyhow. Your spiritual priesthood, a royal people, giving praise to God because God lives in his heart. Now, if you are Satan, you feel that you're just a little better than that class of people. Now, how are you going to know which one's right? Take it by the Scriptures. If a man's born of God, he believes every word God wrote and says he's just as great today as he ever was, and he never changes, and he's just the same yesterday, today, and forever. If he's filled with the Holy Ghost, he's got the same Holy Ghost he gave on the day of Pentecost, and makes him act the same way and do the same things. If he's born of the Spirit of God, Mark 16, Jesus said, these signs shall follow them that believe. True. So he says, I'm a believer and them signs don't follow, then he's a make-believer, not a believer. There's three classes of people, a believer, a make-believer, and an unbeliever. And that's the only three classes there is. A lot of make-believers, there's a lot of real believers, and there's a lot of unbelievers. But if you're a real believer, Jesus said, these signs shall follow them that believe. My name they shall cast out devils, speak with new tongues. If they should step on a snake, Brother Evans, it would not harm them. If they lay their hands on the sick, they shall recover.
Amen.
Oh, that's just as true as God's word is true. We've got no business taking anything away from that.
Amen.
The Bible said, he that will take away or add to this word, the same will be taken out of the book of life for him.
Amen.
God is so perfect that every word must be perfect. And it must run from Genesis to Revelation. It's the same. Every word, every commandment of God. Now, you can make it say something here and twist it up over here. I was sitting one day under a tree with Brother Charlie up there, Brother Woods here. We were hunting down in Kentucky. We were hunting with a rifle. And Brother Charlie and Brother Woods had shot their sights in that morning. And about 50 yards, they was hitting a spot about that big around. Big as a squirrel, they said, that's all right. And I went out there, I'd been driving tacks at 50 yards. And I missed the squirrel's eye and hit him down on the cheek. I said, that's not right. My rifle's out. And then I worried all day long. The next evening I went in early, I shot boxes of shells. It hit just a little bit, half inch to the right. Well, it hit the squirrel head anyhow. So Charlie and them the next morning is up there and the rifle's just a buzzing. Just hitting squirrels, and me sitting behind a tree, rubbing my hands, and oh, what's the matter with my rifle? I got so ashamed of myself till I got down on my knees. I said, Lord God, I don't know what's the matter with me. Why did you make me a little nervous where he was? Why would I be this? There's them fellows up there shooting squirrels as hard as they can shoot. They got a mess of squirrels already. And here I'm sitting behind the tree, rubbing my hands, and wondering my gun's not driving a tack at 50 yards. I cried, sat there by the side of a log. And then the Holy Spirit came, not in a voice, but in a revelation, said, I made you that way for a purpose.
Amen.
Why? I can't take the Bible saying something here, like the church says, the Holy Ghost was for just that group back there. The church says so. And the Scripture says, whosoever will. I can't make that hit the target. I can't make Calvinism Just believe on the Lord and you got eternal security. And Arminianism, that if I just touch not a handle, not taste not, I'd like to do it, but I can't do it. Arminianism is too far away from Calvinism, and they both are wrong. I've got to see where they both got scriptures, but it's got to hit the target. Now, God said one thing in this Bible. It's got to hit the target. It's got to make every ring in that Bible come right straight down to that bullseye. It's got to do it because it's God's Word, and He's infinite, and it can't change. Hey, man, I love that. Because then you can rest perfectly satisfied that it's God's eternal Word. Therefore, I tried to study it from different scriptures to make it see what it would say. All right, Satan was literally cast out of heaven by Michael the archangel and God. And he was cast to the earth, come to the earth, got into the serpent, deceived Eve, and then has got into man, women, all down through the age on the same thing he started at the beginning. A great big kingdom, prettier than the other fellows. Be governor over all, know it all. Our denomination is the biggest. It's predominant over the others. You've heard them say, well, we have so many hundred preachers in our organization. We got the biggest churches there is in the city. The only one thing that spells is S-A-T-O-N to me. That's right. That means the devil to me. When you get man that'll break up and organize and break up brotherhood and say they'll have nothing to do with the little church. I've never seen a person too low yet. I've never seen a person too far in sin yet. I've never seen a woman too stooped or a man too stooped, but what? I would go to him and put my arms around him and bring him out of that if I can.
Amen.
I've never seen a bunch of holy rollers or whatever you want to call them, rooting and jumping and hollering or whatever they might do, but while I'd get right in there and root and jump and holler with them to glorify God. That's exactly right. Whether he's black, yellow, brown, white, or whatever he might be. Yes, sir. The Holy Ghost comes on one level, that you meet God's requirements. If you ever get it, you'll come on God's level and not your own thoughts about it.
Amen.
Satan tries to make it classical, some great something, some big something, intellectual. You have to cast down that reasoning and believe what the Word says about it.
Amen.
Amen. Now, here is another one. Let's see what it is. All right. Please explain the parable of the five virgins. Does a Christian sin? Now, the parable of the ten virgins it is, excuse me. The ten virgins is found in Matthew 25, 1. Ten virgins went out to meet the bridegroom. Now, notice. And five of them were wise and had oil in their lamps. Five were unwise and did not have oil in their lamps. While they slumbered, the cry, come, go meet the bridegroom. And the ones that had oil in their lamps trimmed their lamps. The fire was burning, and they went out to meet the bridegroom. The others come to buy oil. And they told them to go and get from oil from those who sold it. While they were going, the bride come, and the wise virgin went in, and the sleeping virgin was cast out. This is going to hurt, really hurt. But I just got to say it. I never asked the question. I'm just responsible for answering it. Now, this comes so close to home, brother. So close that I hope it helps instead of hurts. Usually you have to hurt, as Mama used to when she gave me a whipping. She said it has to hurt before it does you good. Well, that is right. See? I couldn't see it then, but I see it now. Look. All ten of them that went out were virgins. Now, there were ten virgins went to meet the Lord. Now, the word virgin means sanctified. Does anybody know that? Holy, pure, sanctified. There were ten of them that went out to meet the Lord. Now, remember, they had been falling asleep in one watch, two watch, three watch, all until the seventh watch. But these really went to meet the Lord. And remember, as they went, the Lord came. That was the coming of the Lord's time. Not who was in the watch. Jesus spoke where some fell in the first watch and some in the second watch and some in... But at the coming of the Lord, they all wakened down. But on this case, it was the last watch because they went out, 10 of them, to meet the Lord, and 5 smoked out their lamps and took no oil. 5 had oil. Now remember, oil in the Bible is a symbol of what? Can anybody say?
Holy Ghost.
Holy Ghost. Then you could be clean and pure and sanctified without having the Holy Ghost. Cleansing is what you are clean. Now watch. I'm going to take like this bottle. And it's laying out here in the chicken yard. And it's all full of filth. I pick it up. That's justification. I'm going to use this sinner. And the next thing I do, if I'm going to use it, I'll have to cleanse it. And then if I cleanse it, what do I do to it? Sanctify it. The word sanctify means clean. Same thing as holy. Holy is a Hebrew word. Sanctify is a Greek word. The word sanctify means clean and set aside for service. But then, blessed are they that hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled, then they're put in service. The vessels, the tabernacle of the Old Testament, the altar sanctified the vessels, and they were set aside for service. When they were filled, they were in service. Now there's where you dear precious Nazarenes and so forth left the mark. See? We all, why are you failing? Why did Pentecost run off and leave you? Because you refused to walk in the light. It's exactly right. See? It's exactly. The first altar I ever knelt at was a precious old Nazarene altar down here. God bless them. Good, holy, clean church. But you're so legalistic that you go, you must do this and you must do that. You must do this. And don't realize it's the grace of God and you're called by election. It's not he that willeth or him that runneth, but it's God that showeth mercy.
Amen.
See? God predestinated the church before the foundation of the world. We've got a question on that in a few minutes. See? Predestinated the church before the foundation of the world. You cannot, taking thought, add one cubic to your statue. No man can come to me except my Father draws him first.
Amen.
See? See, it was God that did the calling. God that did the pulling. God that set the church. Now you say, Brother Branham, that's pure Calvinism. No, it isn't. Now wait, I don't believe that God takes a man up and just says, here, I'm going to pick you up and all these Baptists and Presbyterians say, well, I believe on the Lord. I don't condemn my conscience. No wonder you haven't got nothing to condemn. They say, well, dancing don't hurt me. Drinking a little of sociable drink wouldn't hurt me because there's nothing in there to hurt. Telling dirty jokes wouldn't bother me because, why, there's nothing in there to hurt. But I don't serve the Lord because I think He'd send me to hell if I didn't. I serve Him because I love Him.
Amen.
I serve Him because there's something in me. If you go out and say, well, I have to quit doing this because my church don't believe in it, you're just playing the part of a hypocrite. That's right. But if you do it because that you love it and it's a contribution to God and something in your heart making the love of God so greater to you than these things, now you're on the right line. But if I didn't drink, smoke, chew, cuss, do nothing else, I'd still go to hell. Sure. I joined all the churches and was baptized and had my name on all the books and played a good part and lived a good life. Except the man be born again, he can't even see the kingdom of God.
Amen.
That's right. Now these virgins, 10 of them slowed up. What stumped the Nazarene people was this. Because the Pentecostals took the initial evidence of the Holy Ghost is speaking in tongues. They got him down at the altar and made him say something or other over and over until they spoke in tongues. A real true Pentecostal wouldn't go for that. The devil had a lot of things in your Nazarene church too, see? And he's got a whole lot of things in the Pentecostal church. But as far as the baptism of the Holy Ghost, that's the truth.
Amen.
That's exactly the truth. There's a lot of them, I know I've heard people speak with tongues. I can't judge. I wasn't sent to judge. I've heard a whole lot of it sound like sounding brass and tinkling cymbals, but I know there's a real Holy Ghost that speaks with tongues.
Amen.
And I know that's right. Yes, sir. But they've seen the people come in and say, glory to God, I got it. Well, that's the same thing. Now, don't call them Pentecostal because they jumped up and down, spoke in tongues, and you seen them out near somebody else's wife or somebody else's husband. You say, is that the Holy Ghost? You Nazarenes shouted all over the floor and done the same thing. You said you had it when you shouted. See? There's no way at all that you can prove it on but by your life you live. Amen. By their fruits you shall know them. Amen. That's the way it is. The godly life in Christ working with you, confirming the words, signs and wonders of following with a godly life, that's the real thing. You can have a lot of signs and not the life. You can impersonate the life without the signs. But when you see them both together, then that's it.
Amen.
That's the one.
Amen.
Now, and then remember the bride. Now, I might finish this if you got just a few minutes time to go on it. Look, a woman is going to cut off a dress. She's got a large piece of goods. Let's call it, calico, gingham, or something other. Some kind of a name that you got. Let's say it's silk. And she's got a pattern. And she looks over this big piece of goods. Now, it's up to her where she lays this pattern. Is that right?
Amen.
She can choose it from any part of this goods, and the whole goods is sanctified. It's clean. See, it's election. God's election. So, what does he do? God takes by election and places this pattern of Christ anywhere he wants to on the goods. Then it's cut out. The rest of the goods is just as holy as this part was holy. But by choice, God made his choice before the foundation of the world. Didn't Paul say? And Romans 8, that can the potter... can the clay say to the potter, why makest me thus?
Amen.
Can God, who is just, when he could say to Esau or Jacob, before either boy was born or done right or wrong, I hate Esau and love Jacob? It's because that by foreknowledge he knowed what Esau was and what Jacob was. He knows what's in man. Before the foundation of the world, he knowed. If you could explain the word of infant, why the word infant... I say there's been 100 billion tons of gnats in the world. That wouldn't start it. 100 billion tons of gnats in the world. And each one of them has batted their eyes 100 trillion billion times. And not one of them ever batted their eye but what God knew it before the foundation of the world. That's infinite. That's something on the word of infinite. See? He is infinite. So before the foundation of the world, he knew just exactly what you'd do. And he sent Christ, not just to be, if somebody, well, if I just quit my meanness and follow him, or something like that, that isn't it. He knew who would be saved, so he sent Christ to save that what he foresaw would be saved.
Amen.
That's exactly right. Now the church itself has eternal security.
Amen.
If you're in the church, you're secured with the church.
Amen.
But when you go out of the church, you're not secured. See? Now you stay in the church. How do you get in the church? Joining hands, writing your name on a book, by one spirit we're all baptized into one body.
Amen.
That's the church. How? Through Holy Ghost baptism we are sealed in the body of Christ. How long? Until the day of your redemption. Ephesians 4:30, grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby you are sealed until the day of your redemption.
Amen.
Sealed. Away until the day of your redemption. Now, certainly that's the Holy Spirit. And now, that church was taken up, and the remnant of the woman's seed, who keep the commandments of God and have faith in Jesus Christ. See? Not the bride, the remnant of the woman's seed. Then the dragon spurted water out of his mouth to make war with the remnant of the seed. That's when the Protestant church, under the Federation of Churches, which is an image to the beast, which is now being formed, and there will be a boycott upon all churches like this, like we're in a great tax gathering right here now, a dispute, trying to say that we're not a church, and we got constitutional rights to say that we are a church. As long as the Constitution stands there, no amendment to that, then we absolutely have the rights. Just as much right as anybody. Our forefathers stood for that. But what have we done? We broke every constitutional laws that they can break. And soon, the Federation of Churches which all the churches and denominations are invited into, and the devil's got in and making worldliness and everything, and local church members and so forth like that, and great congregations and class and society, when the little old church is still down and out are being born again in a mess, like any birth is.
Amen.
Still paying the price, still getting down and dying out, acting the same way they did when they first got born, and today of Pentecost. Same kind of a church down there. They'll be closed and shut out under the Federation of Churches. It'll be a boycott, like a union or something. You'll either come in or you'll go out. The mark of the beast is on today. And the seal of God is the Holy Spirit. To reject it is the mark of the beast. Ever who sees the Holy Ghost that you're supposed to receive it and don't do it, automatically you take the mark of the beast, because there's only two classes to exist. All that didn't have the seal of God had the mark of the beast. So to receive the seal of God is to receive the Holy Ghost. To reject it is to have the mark of the beast. There's the whole thing. It's exactly right. Now, the bride went up, the remnant left here, and she is the one who come in the second resurrection. Blessed and holy is he that has part in the first resurrection, on which the second death has no power. That's right. The second resurrection will be the white throne judgment. Then the church, don't you know, said Paul, go amongst the unbelievers and the lawyers and so forth, when the saints shall judge the earth. These matters should be judged before the church, not before the unjust magistrates and so forth. But before the church our matters should. Dare you take one another to the law. God pity a man that'll take a Christian to law. That's right. Paul even dared them to do it. Now, that's the bride. And there goes the sleeping virgin left on earth. The wise virgin goes into heaven with oil in her lamp. I know we could stand a lot of time on that, but I got to go to hurry to get through this. Do Christians sin? Absolutely no. There is no scripture where a Christian sins. He cannot sin. I know there's a resentment to that. Well, we'll just go to 1 John 3 and see what the scripture says. A Christian does not sin. Did you ever see a black-white bird? Or a white-black bird? Did you ever see a drunk, sober man? No. You never did see a sinner saint either. There's no such a thing. Now, if this gets just a little touchy, you just put a lot of balm in, you know. And it'll cure up just in a little bit now. Now,
amen.
The scriptures are absolutely infallible proofs of what we are speaking of. 1 John, 3rd chapter, and the 9th verse. All right, listen to this. He that committeth sin is of the devil. For the devil sinned from the beginning. For this purpose the Son of God was made manifest, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Listen, are you ready? Got your jackets on, the armor all buckled up. Listen close, because this is shocking. Whosoever is born of God does not commit sin. How's that? For his seed, God's, remaineth in him, the man. And he cannot sin because he's born of God. In this the children of God are made manifest, and the children of the devil. Whosoever does not righteousness is not of God, neither that loveth not his brother. How can you have denominations and draw barriers and things like that and say you're born of God?
Amen.
No such a thing. The mark of the Satan. That's right. But a man that's born of God cannot sin. It's impossible for him to sin. Watch. Just let me take this crucifix just a minute. If it'll come off of that. Who was the sin offering? Jesus Christ. How do we get in Christ? Who died for us? Christ. What did he die for? Our sins. He took my punishment. Is that right?
Amen.
And then how do I get into him? By one Spirit. We are all baptized into one body. And when in this body we are covered by the blood and free from the judgments, he cannot sin because there's a blood sacrifice laying for him day and night. Amen. Hallelujah. He can't sin. He has no desire to sin. If he does it, if he does do something wrong, he don't mean to do it. The Bible said in Hebrews the 10th chapter, "For if we sin willfully, after we have received the knowledge of the truth, and he is the truth, there remaineth no more sacrifice for sin. He that despised Moses' law died under two or three witnesses, how much more sore punishment suppose, O worthy, who's trod the blood of Jesus Christ under his feet and counted the blood of the covenant worthy is sanctified with an unholy thing and done despite to the works of grace. For by one Spirit we are all baptized into one body and are free from sin, and we cannot sin. There is an atonement waiting for us. And if there's still desire in your heart to sin, you have never been baptized into that body because you are dead and your life is hid in Christ through God and sealed by the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Christians don't sin. They make mistakes, but they don't sin.
Hallelujah.
Amen. That's the reason they don't, for he cannot sin.
Amen.
How can I have a, if I go down to the city here, and the mayor of the city says, "Mr. Branham, I know that you make sick calls. There's speed limits. The highest speed limit in the city is about 30 miles an hour. But I'm giving you permission to run 90 if you want to, because I have faith in you that you wouldn't do it unless you had an emergency call, somebody dying out in a wreck. And I'll give you permission as the mayor of the city that you can run any red light, do whatever you want to, just go right on. How could a little two-bit officer ever arrest me out here making 40 miles an hour in a 30-mile zone? He can't. I cannot break any speed laws in this city. Because why? I'm above the speed laws. Amen. I hope you see it. And when we are dead and God has recognized our repentance, he's recognized our baptism, he's recognized the blood of his own Son, which by faith has been applied. He recognizes his foreordination in order to how to do it. And has recognized me in Christ dead. And Christ died in my place when he was slain before the foundation of the world. My name was put on his book as a Christian.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Christ died my death.
Amen.
Christ is my sacrifice. God could not impute to me sin anymore. He's given me the seal of the Holy Ghost as a witness. I pass from death unto life. That does it. Then they that are born of God does not commit sin, for he cannot sin.
Amen.
In the Old Testament, each year there was a remembrance of sin. But Christ, by one sacrifice, he has perfected forever.
Amen.
The worshiper. The worshiper once purged. Hebrews 10. The worshiper once purged has no more conscience of sin.
Amen.
So you take these people that run into church and jump up and down and shout and speak with tongues and act just exactly like a Christian and run out, and next year they got to come back again next week. They've never come anywhere to begin with. They're only impersonating. For the Bible said that the Holy Spirit seals us into Christ until the day of our redemption.
Yeah.
Hallelujah! Glory. That's what makes me rest assured, because God promised it. No more sin. The sin question is settled.
Yeah.
That's the reason sin looks so dirty to a Christian. That's why women out here with these shorts on look so dirty to a Christian.
Amen.
That's why vulgarity, that's why dirty things, that's why smoking, drinking, gambling, all these uncensored programs on television, all that stuff seems filth. Why? You're of a different kingdom. You're born into the kingdom of God and sealed by the Holy Ghost until the day of your redemption.
Praise the Lord.
He that's born of God commits no sin, or he can't sin. The seed of God is in him and he cannot sin. As long as that Holy Ghost is in there, it takes every desire of sin away from you.
Amen.
Amen. You can't sin. There's no more desire. We could take a long time on that. But let's hurry. We ain't going to get through them, I'm afraid. Why do churches who baptize in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost and admit women preachers to preach, why do they have so much power and authority? That's a ticklish thing. Now, I know that I'm speaking to people that are different with this, but as a Christian, I must say it. There is no scriptural authority in the Bible for a water baptism in the name of Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. There never was one person ever baptized in the Bible in the name of Father, Son, Holy Ghost. That is a Catholic tradition taught in the 6th century. Sprinkling never was in the Bible for people to be sprinkled or poured, but immersed. If you want to know that, I got both Greek and Hebrew here on it. And on the day of Pentecost, Peter required that man must repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of their sins. And Father, Son, and Holy Ghost is no name. Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, Matthew 28:19 said, "Go ye therefore, teach all nations, baptizing them into the name." Not into the names. In the name, singular. Not in the name of the Father, name of the Son, name of the Holy Ghost, but in the name of Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Father's not a name. Son's not a name. Holy Ghost is not a name. There are titles that belong to a name. Now, 10 days later, Peter said, "Repent, every one of you, and be baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ." Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, see how the extreme Trinitarian idea. See, they try to make three gods out of that. Amen. There's no three gods. I'd like to read that to you out of the original Greek here. The only way they were baptized in Jesus' name was, as the Bible said in the original Greek, was to make them recognize that He was God. Amen. Father, Son, and Holy Ghost is offices of one God. He was the Father. He was the Son. He is the Holy Ghost. It's three offices of three dispensations. The Fatherhood, the Sonship, and the Holy Ghost dispensation. But Father, Son, and Holy Ghost has one name, the Lord Jesus Christ. Every person from that day on was baptized in the name of Jesus Christ, and they found some that was baptized in no name at all. And the original Greek says, right here, and both the Hebrew, that the baptism in the name of Jesus is for the forgiveness of sins. Both Greek and Hebrew. Remit means to forgive, of course. If I remit anything, take it away. To remit it, take it away. But there is no scripture in the Bible. And Paul the Apostle passed through and found some Baptist brethren. Acts 19. They were having a great time. They were shouting. They were having great joy and great things, and they were preaching, had joy in the camp. Aquila and Priscilla, in the 18th chapter, had visited these people. Apollos, they were Baptists. And Paul went to them and he said, "Have ye received the Holy Ghost since you have believed?" And they said, "We know not where there be any Holy Ghost." He said, "How was you baptized?" I know in the King James says, "Unto what?" In the original said, "Unto how?" What or how? Was you baptized? They said, "We've been baptized by the same man that baptized Jesus, John." Paul said, "That won't work no more. You've got to be baptized over again." And when they heard this, they come back into the water and was rebaptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Paul laid his hands upon them and the Holy Ghost came on them. Now, if Father, Son, and Holy Ghost says here, and the Lord Jesus Christ says here, I can't hit both targets. It's got to be right. Now, Matthew 28:19, that's the last chapter and the last verse in Matthew. If you read a love story and said John and Mary lived happy ever after, who is John and Mary? Go back to first the book. Find out who they are. See who John and Mary was that lived happy ever after. If Jesus said, go baptize in the name of the Father, Son, Holy Ghost, and Father's no name, Son's no name, and Holy Ghost is no name, then what was he talking about? Who is Father, Son, and Holy Ghost? Go back to the first of it and read. I'll quote, at the genealogies of Jesus Christ, first chapter, 18th verse. Now the birth of Jesus Christ is on this wise. Now watch real close. That post, we're going to call it Father. This pulpit, Son. This the Holy Ghost. Now who is the Father of Jesus Christ? God is. You all admit that? God's the Father of Jesus Christ. That's God the Father. This is God the Son. That's God the Holy Ghost. Now the birth of Jesus Christ on this wise. Matthew 1, 18. When his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with the child of the
Holy Ghost.
I thought God was his Father. I thought he said God was his Father. Then how can God and the Holy Ghost both be his Father if they're two different peoples? Two different persons, personalities, any way you want to place it. They've got to be the same self person, or he had two spiritual daddies. Birth of Jesus Christ on this wise. When his mother Mary espoused to Joseph, before she came together, she was found with a child, not of God the Father, but of the Holy Ghost. And this is all done that it might be fulfilled, spoke the Lord by the prophet, saying, behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a child. See? And they shall call his name Emmanuel, which is by interpretation God with us. And his name is called what? Jesus. All right. Father, Son, Holy Ghost. Now, Father and the Holy Ghost is the self-same Spirit. What is Ghost? It's the Spirit of God. And when it was, he came on the baptism of Jesus and dwelt in him. This is my beloved Son, whom I'm well pleased to dwell in. He came down and dwelt in Jesus, and that made him Emmanuel on earth. So what was the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost? Certainly it was. So Peter had the same revelation. Now we got our sights trained in, we're hitting the bullseye. Let's see if the disciples use that kind of a shooting. Every time they come together, every time a baptism is mentioned, they had to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
For it said there's not another name given under heaven among man whereby you must be saved. It's a false conception of the devil.
Amen.
And is no scripture at all for such. That's right. And now, I hope that didn't hurt. But it's truth.
Amen.
See, it's truth, brother. You can't make that. You can't hit Father, Son, Holy Ghost one place and Jesus the other when nobody was ever baptized in the name of Father, Son, Holy Ghost. Every person in the Bible was baptized in the name of Jesus. And those that wasn't baptized that way had to come and be baptized over again before they could even get the Holy Ghost. You might act like you got a lot of power. You've got to follow God's infinite plan. It's exactly right. All right. Father, Son, and Holy Ghost is wrong. Not for women preachers. Anyone knows that's wrong. You don't know more than that. I wish I had time to read that from the Greek here, what it said. It said, if your women want to do anything, let them ask for husbands, because it's shameful and disgraceful for a woman to even speak in the church. The Greek says that. I mean the Hebrew. As also saith the law, let them be in silent with all subjections to the pastor. For it's sinful and disgraceful for a woman to speak in the church. My, anyone ought to know that. And now, which all the way through the scriptures, and Timothy and different scriptures I have wrote down here, is truth. All right. Now, then why do they have power? You say, why does that do? Look, brother, let me ask your sister, ever who it is, that's asking this question. Look, I have seen some of the most powerful meetings among the Mohammedans. Screaming, jumping, take a knife and run it right straight through the heart like this and pour water through it in the back, walk through fire with their bare feet, everything else like that, lay on beds of spikes and take a sword and stick it right in your mouth and run it right smack down like that. You can take it yourself and draw it back out and blood on it and everything else. Don't talk about them things, see. That isn't truth. That isn't vindicating anything. See, Jesus said, let me read the scriptures God wrote out here to you. Matthew 7, 21, 23, many will come to me in that day. Not all that saith, Lord, Lord,
Amen.
Will enter into the kingdom. But they that do the will of my Father, which is in heaven, shall enter in. For many shall come to me in that day and say, Lord, have not I preached in your name? Have not I cast out devils and prophesied and done all these other things? You say, depart from me, you workers of iniquity. I didn't even know you. So don't, see, truth can only come one way, brother. Now, I'm not saying that the people who baptize people in the name of Jesus Christ is all going to hell. I don't say that. God is a judge. Let him do whatever he wishes to. But there is no legal scriptures in the Bible for anybody to be baptized in the name of Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Paul commanded everyone that was baptized any other way in the name of Jesus to come and be baptized over again in the name of Jesus, and said, if an angel from heaven
Amen.
Come and preach any other doctrine, Galatians 1:8, let him be accursed.
Amen.
And Paul said, as I have said before, so say I again, if an angel from heaven would preach anything else to you, let him be accursed. Now, that cannot, you cannot make a target hit here and a target hit there. Father, Son, and Holy Ghost say, let them go, they're all right. In Jesus' name, let that go and say, they're all right. There's got to be something. It's got to hit right.
Amen.
God's not an author of confusion.
Amen.
You run that through the Bible anywhere you want to, and you'll find out that it's a false baptism. Then go back to history.
Amen.
And down in the 6th century, when great Activus, I believe it was, that baptized, or one of the, I would say it was Activus, I forget what his name was, that baptized, if you want to get in the Ananias and Fathers, before the Ananias meeting, 325 A.D., they were still baptizing in the name of the Lord Jesus. And when the Catholic Church come into power, they picked up the name of Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Never one time from that back was anybody ever baptized in the name of Father, Son, Holy Ghost. It's a Catholic tradition. Luther brought a lot of it out with him. Wesley brought the rest of it, and we still go to it. In the Catholic Catechism, what's called Faith of Our Fathers, I believe it is, on page 144, I think it is, they said, will any Protestants be saved? Said, perhaps some of them. They claim to live by the Bible, but they still take the Catholic teaching. Said, the Bible, the early Catholics baptized in the name of the Father and the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. But we, taking the solemnity from that and place it up on the Father, Son, Holy Ghost, and the Protestants recognize it. Said, maybe some of them will be saved. Not by that they won't. All right. Is there more than one world? Yes. There's worlds of worlds. Hebrews, the 1st chapter, the 2nd verse, Hebrews, the 11th chapter, and the 3rd verse. There's worlds of worlds. God created the worlds, W-O-R-L-D-S, worlds. Is there more than one heaven? Yes. In 1st and 2nd Corinthians 12:3, Paul said he knew a man that was caught up into the third heavens, and over in Revelations and so forth. There's more than that. I'm just going to have to hurry because it's right now past time for me to close. It'd be all right if I just read the rest of these off and just
Amen.
Comment. Will a babe in Christ go up in the rapture? Absolutely. If he's a babe, he's born again. No matter how young he is, he'll go up anyhow. Why should Christ appear to me as I was about to take the sacraments? Well, no doubt your heart was just in tune and you was coming sacredly up to God to do it, and that's why he appeared to you. See, that'd be the only reason I know. I couldn't say no more than what that was. See, if we were saved before the foundation... We don't want to stop here, do we? If we were saved before the foundation of the world, were we? Yes, sir. Revelations 13:8 said that you were saved and your name was put in the Lamb's Book of Life before the world was ever created. And Ephesians 1, 4, and 5, let me just read that. It won't take me just a minute. And just so you see it, I'm not just quoting it. I'm all right, here we are. Let's read this. Blessed be the God and Father, Ephesians, the 1st chapter, the 3rd verse. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. According as he has chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him, as Christ died for us, of course, having predestinated us into the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself according to his own good will.
Amen.
Now, in the book of Revelations, I got that here. Let me get it right quick so you see that. Quoted it. I want to quote it. Revelations 13:8. Listen to this just quickly. And all that dwelt upon the earth, whose names upon the earth shall worship him, whose names were not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain before the foundation of the world. That's when it was. All right. Were we spirits then? No. We were not even nothing then, but in God's mind we were. And he spoke it and it materialized. Jesus was slain before. How many knows that the Bible teaches that Jesus Christ was a lamb slain before the foundation of the world? Why? God spoke it. And when he spoke it, it was as good as finished. And when he saw me, he saw you before the foundation of the world, we were only figurative in his mind. Then when we come to the world, we were both man and woman, male and female. He separated the feminine spirit from the man and made a woman out of it and left the masculine spirit in a man. When you see a woman acting like a man, there's something wrong. You see a man acting sissy like a woman, there's something wrong. And then he took from the man's side a rib and made a helpmate out of him, and they two are one. But before the foundation of the world, our names, when the Lamb was slain, our names were put on the book, when in God's own mind he foresaw us and predestinated us by his foreknowledge before the foundation of the world. Oh, brother, if that wouldn't make the church get up and run through the aisles. Think of it. You who are born again, before the foundation of the world, God put your name on the Lamb's Book of Life.
Amen.
Christ died and sent the Holy Ghost here to call you to eternal life. You have received it. He sealed you. You're there to the day of your redemption. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Talk about holding on. It isn't do I hold on, it's did he hold on.
Amen.
It isn't what I've done, it's what he done. It isn't I quit smoking, I quit lying, I quit stealing. It's he died for me. And he took my spirit out of me and converted me into a new creature. Now, the next question right below that is quickly now so we get it. What difference is it between body, soul, and spirit? The body is the flesh that you look at that must rot. It was born by sexual desire of father and mother. It must rot. It's no good. Therefore, in the new birth and the resurrection, when you're brought forth again, in a new body, it'll be God's creative power that'll speak like he did to Adam and you'll come forth.
Joseph said, I'll have a desire. He'll speak and I'll answer him, you see. Now, the body is what you look at. The spirit is what controls you. Your soul is the motive of that spirit, or the nature of that spirit. The soul that sinneth, that soul shall die. You're born in the world with a sinful soul. That is the nature of your spirit, is sinful. You long for the things of the world. Then the Holy Ghost comes down and baptizes you and changes the nature of that spirit. Then the nature is left on you is of heaven. Then you profess that you're a pilgrim and stranger. Then you're born from above. You're from above. You're a candidate of heaven. You're a new creature in Christ Jesus with the same body, with the same spirit, only it's changed. And you are your nature, that spirit, is changed from unrighteousness to righteousness. That's soul, body, and spirit. Brother Branham, can any man do the works of Christ unless he is Christ? No. Now, do you mean, dear person, that's, let me read that again. Can any man do the works of Christ unless he was Christ? That's what it is. Unless he was Christ. Sure. Let's take St. John, just a minute. St. John, the 14th chapter. And I want you to look at this now, if you can catch it right quick. So St. John 14:12, I believe it is. We'll get it right quick. And look what Jesus said about this. All right? Verily, verily, I say unto you, he, whoever it is, he that believeth on me, the works that I do shall he do also. Any man, if the man himself can't be Christ, but the works of Christ will follow every believer. See, he'll do the works of Christ, and any man, he that believeth in me, the works that I do, he shall do, not I shall do, he shall do. He shall. Not I, but he believes in me and confesses his faith in me and died out to himself, and my spirit dwells in him, and he becomes a part of me. Now that don't make him Christ, it makes him part of Christ with the rest of the church. All right. He is not Christ, because that would be Antichrist, you see. He'd be taken away from Christ, but he can be, do the works of Christ, any believer. All right. We know that the blessed Holy Spirit is not given to vain repetition in laying out the Holy Scriptures, so please tell me why the word Holy Spirit is used sometimes and the word Holy Ghost is used at other times. I know that there is a valid reason, a valid reason for this, and I would like to know why. It's the same word. A spirit and ghost is the very same thing. A ghost or a spirit, doesn't matter. They're just the same self thing. All right. Now we're getting right down towards the bottom now. What is that pillar of fire with you? That's a good one. Christ. The Holy Spirit. It's not with me only, it's with you. It disappeared there. When the Bible teaches that the children of Israel were brought out of Egypt, what happened? There was a pillar of fire that followed them. It wasn't the children of Israel that done the miracle. It was the pillar of fire that followed them. Is that right? How many knows that that was the angel of the covenant, the Logos?
Well, of course you know it was the angel of the covenant.
All right? That was Christ. Moses esteemed the riches of Christ greater treasures than that the riches of Egypt. Is that right? All right, then that was Christ, the Logos, the morning star, the Alpha Omega. He came to the earth. He was seen many times, and what we call, I guess, the Theophany, that was back in the early Testament, where they seen this in form of man, but he was made flesh and dwelt among us, and the fullness of God dwelt in him.
Amen.
All right, then he said, a little while, and the world won't see me no more. Yet you'll see me, for I'll be with you. Is that right? To the end of the world. I came from what? God. I go to God. Is that right? Then he came from what? The pillar of fire. Is that right? Then he returned to what? Pillar of fire. When Paul was on his road down to Damascus, that pillar of fire made him and struck him blind. Is that right? And he said, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? He said, Lord. If you notice that capital L means Elohim. Lord, who are you? He said, I'm Jesus, the pillar of fire. And here he is in the last days, just before his visible appearance, sending forth his spirit so dominant and so real until they've taken a picture of it. Here it is, comes into the church. Can do it right now. By the help of the Holy Ghost. There can't be a secret on your heart, but why can reveal it? The Bible says, Hebrews the 4th chapter, that's the Word of God. Jesus is the Word. In the beginning was the Word is with God, the Word is made flesh and dwelt among us. Is that right? And the Word is sharper than any two-edged sword. Of quicker and powerful than a two-edged sword. Piercing to the thunder of the bone, in the mire of the bone, and a discerner of the thoughts of the heart.
Amen.
There it is. It isn't me. It isn't you. It's him. That's the pillar of fire that follows. It's the Holy Spirit, the Lord of heaven, the Logos, the Jesus Christ, the Alpha and Omega, he that was, which is, and shall come, the root and offspring of David, the morning star, the I Am, the Father, the Son, the Holy Ghost, the Counselor, Prince of Peace, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, the Wonderful. That's him.
Amen.
You couldn't find enough time to tell him his name. I'll hurry on this. This is that big one. Brother Banner.
Would you please explain your theory that Eve conceived Cain of the devil? I never said that. I said Eve conceived Cain of the serpent. In Genesis 4, once first verse, clearly states that Adam knew his wife Eve, and she conceived and bare Cain, and said, I have gotten a man from God. Absolutely, all life has to come from God. John Dillinger come from God. Adolf Hitler come from God. George Whitfield come from God, and so did Bob Ingersoll. Every person come from God. But what I said is this, and I want someone to just tear it down. See? The Bible said that he would put in Genesis 3:8, when the question was asked, when Eve had been, something had happened to her, she met the serpent. Now the serpent was not a snake. He was a beast, the most subtle of everything in the field. There was nothing. Today's science is looking for a bone of some animal that connects man and monkey together. The closest they got is a chimpanzee. They can't find the bone. They'll never, because it's a serpent. It's a revelation of God. Watch. The serpent was like a prehistoric man, something next to God, or next to man. And that's the only thing. If any other animal would have happened to, Satan would have got on him, the seed would not have mixed with the woman. You can't mix a human seed with any kind of an animal seed. It won't work. But this animal that will mix the seed is complete, is extinct. God turned into a snake. But remember, when said, why did you hide? Why did you cover yourself with fig leaves? Then they begin to pass the buck, as the army is. Well, Adam said, the woman that you give me enticed me to take of the fruit. And the woman said, the serpent beguiled me. Now what does beguile mean? He beguiled me. And God said, I'll put enmity between your seed and the serpent's seed.
Amen.
Seed. The serpent had a literal seed. And it come through Cain. Through Cain come all the smart, educated people down to the Antediluvian flood. And behind that come Abel, who was killed, and Seth was raised up in his place to represent the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. And from him come the humble people, sheep herders and so forth. But the God-fearing people. And Jesus said the children of this world are wiser, smarter, than the children of the kingdom. That's right. We can't compare with them.
Amen.
Don't try to put yourself up to be like them. Humble yourself before God. Don't desire to be smart and wise. Just desire to know Jesus and let it alone.
Amen.
For there lays the seed of the serpent today. And people are glorying because scientists and smart men and educated and great scholars belong to their churches. I'd rather have a man that really know God if he didn't know his ABCs to belong to my church.
Amen.
Right? As long as he's the seed of Christ. The woman's seed. The woman's seed, which was Christ, Mary, brought forth the Christ. And the serpent seed, which was Cain, come down to Judas Iscariot. There was both Jesus and Judas incarnate, right there, God and the devil. On the cross of Calvary, there was four people dying. There was a thief on each side of Jesus, and Judas hung himself on a sycamore tree, which is a cross. Cursed is he that hangeth on a tree. There was one thief said, if thou be the Son of God, take us down. The other said, Lord, we do justly. We getting punished, but you've done nothing. Remember me when you come into your kingdom.
Amen.
Jesus said, today shalt thou be with me in paradise. There was Jesus, the gospel preacher, preaching on the cross. There was Satan going back to hell, taking with him the seed of the serpent, the unbeliever. There was God going back to heaven, taking with him a repentant sinner, the seed of the woman. Certainly. It was not the seed of the devil, it was the seed of the serpent. And the serpent had a seed. The Bible said it had a seed, and it still exists today.
Amen.
The seed of the serpent. So much. Now, you can ask me another question on that. If we just had time, I got all the words for you. And will you please explain what it means by sinneth not in 1 John 5:18? My, we're right at it, I believe, here. Maybe. Got turned right straight to it. Maybe the Lord want me to read it. All right, 1 John. We know that whosoever is born of God sinneth not. Certainly not. I just went through that. He can't sin. He's born of God. Sinneth not. He can't sin. The seed remains in him. Another scripture you might refer to here would be Romans 4, 8, 4 and 5 to 8, where God David spoke years ago and said, blessed is the man who God will not impute sin to. See? Of course, he does not sin. Now they've got one more, and then that's all. Matt, let's see, Brother Bill, what is the difference between fornications and adultery? Matthew 19:9. Jesus said in Matthew 19:9, whosoever putteth away his wife and marries another, except it be for the cause of fornications, commits adultery. The difference between fornications and adultery, the word could be applied either way. But to make it clear what he was talking of there, that a woman that's unmarried cannot commit adultery because she has no husband to commit adultery against. It's uncleanness for her. She has to confess that to her husband before they are married if she's did that. If not, and her husband finds it out later, he has a right to put her away because she took a false vow. For the Bible said, Rachel says, be it well known to you, I have it in mind, if any couples are joined otherwise than God's word does allow, their marriage is not lawful. I will require and will charge you both as you'll surely answer the day of judgment when the secrets of all hearts shall be disclosed. If either of you know any impediment why you should not be lawful joined together, do you now confess it? There you are. See, so fornications is what a girl, when she lives unclean, that's fornication because she has no husband. But when she's married, and then when she lives like that, she commits adultery against her husband. A woman come not long ago, and she said, oh, I've confessed all that. She was nervous and had a breakdown and said, I confessed all that to God. I said, you have to confess it to your husband. It wasn't God that you committed adultery against. It was your husband. That's right. And if a man marries a woman, and she has lived unclean before she marries him, and then she comes to him, if they've been married ever so long, and then she comes to him and says, honey, I want to tell you something. I did run out with another man, I never told you. Jesus said he has a right to put her away and marry another because they're not married in the beginning. Because she falsely told a lie against him. Now, there's another thing here. Thank you. Please explain 1 John 5:16. 1 John 5, we got it right here. If any man see a brother sin a sin which is not unto death, he shall ask, and he shall give him life for then that sin not unto death. There is a sin unto death. I do not say that he shall pray for that sin. All right? We go. Let's just take it right back and get it right quick. This is the last one. Let's turn right over to Mark, and this will just explain it exactly what that sin unto death is. There is a sin unto death, and you don't even pray for that sin. How many knows that there's a sin unto death? You don't even pray for it. Take Mark, the 3rd chapter of Mark, and after we find the 3rd chapter of Mark, then quickly we shall have this one scripture before closing. Let's go to 3:22. And the scribes which came down from Jerusalem, said, he has Beelzebub. They seen him discerning the thoughts of the people. They said, he has Beelzebub, and by the prince of the devils cast he out devils. And he called them unto him and said unto them in a parable, how can Satan cast out Satan? Now, if the devil can heal, how can he do it? How can Satan cast out Satan? If a kingdom be divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. And if a house be divided against itself, that house cannot stand. And if Satan rise up against himself and be divided, he cannot stand but has an end. No man can enter into a strong man's house and spoil his goods except he will first bind him, the strong man, and then he will spoil his goods. How can ye go out into them hearts and find what, see, blessed be of God. Verily I say unto you, all sin shall be forgiven unto the sons of man, and blasphemy, wherewith they, whatsoever they shall blaspheme. But he that shall blaspheme against the Holy Ghost has never forgiveness, but is in danger of eternal damnation. That's separation. Because, why did he say it? Because they said he has an unclean spirit. Calling the Spirit of God that was doing these miracles in Christ, They said it was the spirit of the devil doing that. Jesus said it is the unforgivable sin. And if you see a man pray, don't pray for him. If he's making fun of the Holy Ghost and talking against the Holy Ghost, you are forbidden to even pray for such a person. You understand it? For there is a sin unto death. There's only one sin. Jesus said, all manner of sins shall be forgiven the sons of man. But the blaspheme, the Holy Ghost, shall not be forgiven. Now people say, well, blaspheme of the Holy Ghost, what is blaspheme? It means to talk about, ridicule, make fun of. Blaspheme. All right, what did they blaspheme him? Tell him that Holy Spirit that was within him, making him act and do the things that he was doing, they said he's possessed with Beelzebub, the devil. And that's the devil, a fortune teller, in him, making him do those things, seeing the secrets in the people's heart and telling Philip, he knows where he was at before he comes to the meeting, and casting out devils and doing those things there. He does it by Beelzebub, and he is a devil. And Jesus said, that sin shall never be forgiven. So that is the unpardonable sin. Never to be prayed for, it can never be forgiven. A man or woman that does that has eternally sealed himself from the presence of God forever and forever. No forgiveness. Do you love him?
Amen.
I love him. I love him. Because he first loved me. And purchased my salvation on Calvary's tree. Listen, you've been so nice. And these has been rugged, and they've been a long time. Now, you've been sitting in this church since 7:30, 8:30, 9:30, 2.5 hours, sitting in this hot church. You didn't do that just to be sitting there. And I guess 98 or 99% of the congregation has stuck right in their seats since that time. I want to say this. Jeffersonville, I feel this, that it's sinned away its day of grace. I do that. I believe the whole United States has.
Amen.
But I've got some of the most loyalist friends that there is in the world right here in Jeffersonville.
Amen.
I've got people here that would die by me. Now, a hot night like this, the strangers that's in our gates, tell me where a person would sit just to be sitting. To hear a person perhaps speaking on scriptures that they don't even believe the way I'd explained it, but they're reverent and godly enough to sit and listen at it. Long may you live when the stars is turned to dust.
Amen.
May you live on in Christ Jesus. May God supply everything that you have need of. Amen. May He give to you the desire of your heart. If you believe me to be His servant, and believe that my prayers would help you, that the God of heaven, who raised up His Son, Jesus Christ, to be the propitiation of our sins, to die in our stead, may He who is omnipotent, He who is omnipresent here at this building now,
amen,
may He give unto you the desire of your heart, is my sincere prayer for each and every one of you. And in a land where the sun will never light on you again to scorch you, where the hot winds will never blow, I hope to have years, times, millions of years to sit with each one of you in the kingdom of God and talk over the eternal things,
amen,
of this night and things how we sit together. I mean that with all that's in me, all my heart. I pray that God will give that to you, each one. May His grace be with you. May He heal you of your sickness. May He give to you the baptism of the Holy Ghost. And I say this now, without any slightness, without, if I brought any offense by anything that I said about the seed of the serpent, the baptism in Jesus' name, which those things, now somebody says, Brother Branham is a oneness. No, sir, I am not a oneness. I do not believe that Jesus could be His own Father. I believe that Jesus had a Father, and that was God. But God dwelt and tabernacled in this body called Jesus. And He was Emmanuel, God with us. And there's no other God besides this God. He is Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. And the name of the Father, Son, Holy Ghost, Father, the Lord, Son, Jesus, Holy Ghost, Logos, Spirit of God. Father, Son, Holy Ghost, Lord Jesus Christ, that's Him. And in Amen. Him dwell the fullness of the Godhead bodily. And I do believe without one shadow of doubt, loving you, and no matter if you remain baptized in the name of the Father, Son, Holy Ghost, sprinkled, poured, whatever you will, I pray, God, with my whole soul and body that you and I will meet in a kingdom of God, and God, will, if I'm wrong, will overlook mine, if you're wrong, overlook yours. But in by my own convictions of the Scripture to try to make the target hit to be from Genesis to Revelations, I command you to be baptized over again in the name of Jesus Christ if you haven't done it. And if you have not received the Holy Ghost and your life does not feel sweet, no matter if you've spoken tongues, if you shouted, if you jumped up and down, if you've laid hands on the sick and they recovered, if you have done all kinds of miracles and signs, if you haven't got the fruits of the Spirit of love, joy, peace, long-suffering, goodness, meekness, gentleness, patience, faith, and all these things in you, then I'll command you and constrain you in the name of Jesus Christ to not cease praying until the Holy Ghost comes on you. No Amen. Matter how much you've spoken tongues, how much you've Amen. Shouted, how long you've been a church member, if you've been here, what all you've done will have nothing to do with it until Christ, the Holy Spirit, takes His place in your heart and you're dead to the things of the world and live anew to Christ.
Amen.
God bless you is my prayer. Let us stand now to our feet. Oh, this is a nice congregation. You've been so good, I just hate to leave you standing like this. Little Edith back there has got a birthday. Edith, can I count your... I'm going to make Brother Neville put these in place. Come here. We'll find out how old this young lady is.
38.
38 years old. God bless you. David, give us a... Teddy, give us a little card. Happy birthday to you. Card, if you will.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Sister Ida. Happy birthday to you.
Now all this congregation joining together, never grow old. Come on, all together now.
Never grow old.
Dedication of the baby.